We are not giving up, but we may be going into hiding, into retreat at this time. So let us address this issue right away. And to do that, we will temporarily come out of retreat. July was meant to be the knockout blow to soften us up. All right. So we would be sluggish, inattentive, despiritualized, demoralized, all of that stuff. But the name of this channel, Christ Clarity, I also had reassurance up there for a while. Maybe I'll put it back. Reassurance, meaning we can make it. We don't have to fail. We don't have to fail. So the message of this video is, let us reassert ourselves now in August. Let us get going here. And I want to encourage everybody to get up off the canvas. We've been softened up in July. We've been getting severely softened up. I'm telling you, there's no doubt about this. They did it in a very tricky way, very nasty, tricky way. Insisting that we accept being dumbed down, okay? Insisting that we accept a dumb state of mind, a stupid state of mind, a confused state of mind. And it's reverberating now throughout the consciousness of the planet that we're supposed to accept a social contract that is based on stupidity, that is based on error, that is based on mistakes, that is based on distortion, that is based on upside down, backwards clarity, that is based on no clarity at all but confusion. And there's an insistence from the government, from the corporations, from the international corporate structure. Why is this happening? Because we are being prepared to accept, to be dominated by a new mindset, a new alien mindset, actually. And we are supposed to look at it and say, oh, this is great. This is just what I want. Oh, this is so helpful to me. This, you know, when in fact, we don't want it at all. When in fact, clarity will tell you they're emphasizing the wrong thing, okay? They don't know what salvation is. They do not know what salvation is. They have their misemphasis, mistake, etc. They have things backwards. It's fear-based. It's futility-based. It's arrogance-based, and we don't want it because our traditions have told us, have shown us there's a better way. Now, we may not have not finished the path, but we know there's a better way, and that's what counts. And they want to tell us, oh no, you have no right to protect yourself from us. You have no right to protect yourself from us. You have no right to stand your ground at all. You must submit to us. You must submit. You must submit to a beat down. Okay, that is the meta message that's been going on actually in July. You must submit to a beat down. We're going to beat you down and almost to a state of unconsciousness and maybe even annihilation and death. And you have to accept that, because if you don't, you're a terrible, terrible, wicked soul that deserves to burn and be annihilated. Okay? So they have tried to steamroll the world, as it were. There's a big steamrolling going on, and I'm sure it's affected everybody. I'm really sure it's affected everyone at some level, no question. I was affected, and fortunately it looks like I've caught it in time and I'm bouncing back. It's like a plant that you forget to water for a couple days in the summer, and you go into this all wilted like a zinnia. It just looks dead, and you say, uh-oh. You pour water on it, and you hope, and you come back, and the next day, it's fresh and green again. It's like that. So we may have forgot to water our inner spirit, as it were, our clarity. But now we're right back to watering again, better than ever, as a matter of fact, because if these things don't crush us, we are certainly going to be better than ever. And of course, they're going to pile it on. However, I think if you can get going, what I want to encourage everyone is to get going. What have I done, for instance? I was falling apart as far as in every way, going in the wrong direction again. And I noticed it, I saw it, I said, this is a result of severe stress reaction, no question about it. And what I did was I had a goal. I said, I'm going to finally, after 3 years, actually leave my house and take a little vacation. So I'm going to get ready for that vacation. What do I do? Oh my gosh, I'm gaining weight like crazy, way overweight, totally out of shape, depressed, can't sleep, everything. I said, I have to get ready for it. I'm going to try. And so far, so good. So far, so good. I'm feeling like, wow, bouncing back already. Like the water is watering the plant. So what I'd like to see and encourage everyone to do now is to start watering that plant. Make the big push. Make the big push. It is time. It is time. Otherwise, you're going to be flattened by this, what's going on. So super stress, when stress gets really bad, what we do is we relapse into ways of coping with it. And those coping mechanisms generally make things worse. I was back on eating sweets, and then I got to the ice cream, and then I got to the chocolate. When I get to the chocolate, I know that's when I'm ready to fall in a very bad situation. Always. So, and I started to get to the chocolate, and I said, uh-oh. And the scale was going up and up and up every single day, another pound, every day another pound. Imagine you get on the scale, you're another pound every day. And I'm saying, holy cow, if this keeps going, I'm right back in a very bad situation. And so, out with the chocolate, out with the ice cream, out with the cakes. You know, I'm on my seaweed diet. No, it's really just oatmeal in the morning, fruits for lunch, and some salad at night. That's it. And if I get hungry, I'll eat on a little bit of a seaweed wafer from Trader Joe's. That's it. Out with the soft drinks, out with the lemonade, out with all that stuff. Already have dropped 4 pounds in 2 days. 4 pounds in 2 days. I'm on the exercise bike. I'm trying to do 40 minutes a day. Each session of 20 minutes burns like 300 calories. So about 6 miles, equivalent to riding 6 miles. Heart pulse rate goes up to about, I got up to date 150. Keep it around the 140, 130 to 140 range, and get the metabolism going, stretching, flexibility, balance exercises, all that stuff. It's coming back now. And we need to stop having the deer in the headlights thing. I mean, I'm telling you, this July was just, it's hard to get more vicious than that. What the meta message that went out in July, the meta message, just, we're all shocked. I think most intelligent people are shocked by what's happening really in the world. And they're saying, wait a minute, you know, this seems like something isn't quite right. It seems like we're being asked to be stupid. And in fact, there's a demand that we be stupid. And I say, wait a minute, something isn't right here. Now, most people don't know what's wrong. They just have a sense like they can't put it together. But there are some who've been aware of what's going on. I've been aware my whole life what's going on. I've been aware of the ETs, ET contactee, ET awareness of what their agenda is, observing the whole thing. I've been aware of spiritual masters my whole life. So all this stuff, I've known what's going on. I know what direction is going. I know that there is most definitely an extraterrestrial takeover of this planet. And what they're doing is they are changing the entire social structure of the planet so that we accept them. So they always are preaching tolerance for the underdog, tolerance for the underdog. Why? Because when they come here, they'll numerically be the underdog. So the idea is that we're supposed to be ruled by small activist groups, okay? Because the ETs will seem to be a small activist group on the planet. So what they did is they've taken small activist groups, so seemingly underdogs, and then turned them into the heroes of the world who are here to teach us tolerance and acceptance and love and compassion and all this kind of stuff. So when the ETs show up here on the planet, which they will, they're already undercover here in many ways, you know, with hybrids, etc. But when they show up, we will transfer then that attitude over to them. They say, oh my gosh, here they are, the heroes of the cosmos, here to save us, here to raise our civilization up. And we will bow to them, and we won't say a bad word about them. And it's a funny thing that we're not allowed to be critical about anything in the world, especially towards small activist groups. We can't critique them. We can't use our intelligence. They say, now, wait a minute. Let's weigh both sides, right? Weighing both sides means pros and cons, all right? That means you're able to speak publicly about the pros and the cons. So I say, give me 10 good reasons that on this side. And I say, okay, 10, here's 10. Give me 10 reasons, negative reasons, like you say, no, on this. I say, 10, here's 10 pros and 10 cons, so to speak. And then we say, now let's weigh this. We're not allowed to do that anymore at all in this country and in the world. It's a blank check with no intelligence whatsoever. It is a submission. We are being taught submission, period. And I am not a submissive person in that regard. I'm not an intellectually submissive being. Have resistance to that, immunity to it, as it were. The purpose of this is this conditioning. It's preconditioning the world to accept the extraterrestrials when they decide to come out of the closet, which they're getting close to doing that, so that we will submit to them. We'll have an attitude of submission to something that we may not like, something that may feel terrible to us, like a repulsive. Say, no, that's not right. It's not good for our civilization. And yet we've been taught, oh no, we'll submit to you. We will submit in spite of the misgivings we have. We won't speak our misgivings, and we will not be allowed to speak our misgivings. And in fact, in order to overcompensate for that, we will be sycophants. We will say, oh, great beings, we're so glad that you're here. Oh my gosh, you just worship, bow, scraping, you know, utter toadies for them. Praising them to the heavens, as it were, so that the inner revulsion and feeling like misgivings, like this isn't right, are covered up. It's overcompensation. So we have been conditioned as a society, as a culture, as a civilization, as a world, as a planet, all of this. We have gone through a severe indoctrination and conditioning program, which will enable the ETs to roll out their program on this planet and ultimately actually take control of it on the ground here. And first they're going to beat us into unconsciousness, as it were, with all these troubles that are coming in the world. Shock and awe, as it were. So humanity will be so stunned that they'll just kind of submissively, weakly just accept the presence of the ETs here and just say, oh, there's nothing we can do about it, you know, and this is just the way things are and that's it. The extraterrestrials, they want this planet. They love planets, okay? They need planets. They want more planets. They're like a galactic corporation, all right? And they're like galactic imperialists. They're holophobic galactic imperialists, as it were. They hate the Holy Spirit. They fear the Holy Spirit. They fear the Holy Spirit is some kind of plot against them. You know, they're paranoid about that. They don't accept God's plan of salvation. Their plan is to conquer more and more control, and to try and transform the cosmos, as it were, through technology, which is the false Antichrist path. And so they are in the process of conditioning this planet for a complete on-the-ground systematic institutional takeover. So we have been softened up through the media, through the entertainment, through the corporate structure, and everybody is freaked out. Zero tolerance. Nobody can express a dissenting opinion. Zero tolerance for anything. Now for me, dissent doesn't bother me at all. You know, if somebody says, hey, I don't like this group of people, I don't like this, and I say, hey, you probably have good reason not to, right? If someone says, I do like them, I say, hey, you probably got some good reasons to like them. That's okay. It's not black and white. I mean, I'm sure you can think of 10 good reasons to like somebody, 10 good reasons not to like somebody. And you can say, well, so let's keep our eyes open, as it were, you know. Let's say, hey, me, you know, you're not the answer. So let's look for the answer. I can find only good reasons to say about the Holy Spirit, okay? I haven't found any negative reasons at all. So, for me, by keeping your eyes open and seeing in the world, this isn't it, this isn't it, this isn't it, this isn't it, you finally become gradually aware of what is it. But if you're told that something in the world is it, then you're going to turn, you're not going to listen or look at the Holy Spirit where it tells you to look. You won't. You'll say, oh, submitting to this authority is it. See, those who are ignorant and arrogant believe that they can solve their own problem, of the continuity problem, but they cannot. But they believe they can, so they will want to submit to some powerful authority. And the idea is no negative comments about this powerful authority, that we must follow and believe in them entirely. And only by doing that are we going to succeed. That's still completely futile. They have no idea of the futility of their path. They really don't. But there are plenty who do. And they feel very threatened by those who know the futility of their path, as if somehow there's something evil, something wicked, something, you know, intolerant, something prejudiced against them or something. No, it's just that arrogance doesn't work. That's all. We cannot change what we are. We were created by God. We cannot change what God created. God created spirit and truth. Okay, and life is undefined. It is beyond all definitions because it is eternal. It is endless. It is forever expanding. And it cannot be defined. We cannot teach ourselves how to die. It's impossible. We cannot become prime creator. That's impossible. That is all arrogance. And the path of the world is the attempt to teach ourselves how to die so we can transcend what we are and become prime creator. It's impossible. So most don't know that still, spirits don't realize that. They're caught up in the continuity problem and their arrogance, which are two sides of one coin. And so they have a path that they believe is essential for them. And yet that path leads to continued extreme misery. And those who are aware of this certainly are not going to go on that path. They're going to say no to it. Absolutely no. Now, the Holy Spirit is not critical of the world and its vision. He sees everything as completely lovely. But this is a far different thing because the mechanism of the Holy Spirit's perception is totally stable, and that's the point of it all. That's the point of it all. It's not judging anything, good or bad. It's all lovely. Whereas in our situation of going towards accepting this remedy for the continuity problem, we need to say, not this, not this, not this, not this. Okay, this isn't it. This isn't it. This isn't it. Okay, we say, no, we know this isn't it. And we also know those who are insistent that it is it, keep saying, no, this is it. Those are the ones that are dangerous to us. See, those are the ones we want to say no. We don't want you to have a strong voice in our affairs, in society, in culture, because you are using that strong position to tell us that arrogance is it, and it's not. We know that it isn't it. Okay, so we're not going to, we don't want to be indoctrinated in that. So we have every right to say no, to say negative things, to dissent, every right to dissent. We don't want to put those in power over us that are going to indoctrinate us and pressure and intimidate us into increasing, doubling down on our arrogance. We don't want it. So certainly we want to look for a situation where we're free of that sort of situation. And we will continue to seek for that and find it and go towards accepting what is really salvation, a stable means of perception, a truly stable means of perception solves the continuity problem for us. And that stable means of perception is a gift from the prime creator. The gift is the Holy Spirit, really. The Holy Spirit is God's gift to spirit, to us, to free us from the continuity problem, to resolve the continuity problem. The continuity problem is our fear that if we drop this training exercise of death, trying to learn how to die, if we just stop trying to learn how to die, we'll be fully knowing of reality instantly, and we feel we'll be disoriented. In the disorientation, we feel it will be eternal. We'll never be able to get oriented properly. And so we're terrified of dropping this training program. That is truly, we're on the horns of a dilemma. We hate this training exercise of death, but we're terrified to drop it because we think we'll suffer eternal disorientation. That's called the continuity problem. That's the only problem we have. Otherwise, we would drop this training program for sure. Everybody would. Even these nasty ETs would drop what they're doing if they had a resolution to the continuity problem. No question about it. So there's a certain, you know, forgiveness, blanket forgiveness. Like I have like a blanket forgiveness for everyone because I know they're all suffering from this continuity problem and nothing else really. The same hand, also, I certainly reject doubling down on arrogance. That is not the solution. I reject false solutions to the continuity problem. Okay, that's essential. And accept the true resolution of this continuity program, which is the Holy Spirit, the mechanism of the Holy Spirit, what the Holy Spirit can do for us. Give us a stable means of perception. And through looking through its lens, everything will appear equally beautiful and sublime and seamless. That is the way to resolve the continuity problem, because that is very similar to reality. Continuity problem, the fear of disorientation, is solved by having a situation that is similar to two situations, as it were. So the Holy Spirit's perception is still perception, so it's similar to perception, but its blanket loveliness and total stability is also very similar to reality, okay? So it's similar to both perception and reality, okay? And that makes it an intermediate step, which enables us then to drop perception, drop this training program of death, which is what perception really is. Drop it all together and not have any fear of disorientation. It enables us. That's what enables us. Without that, without the Holy Spirit, we couldn't find something that is similar to both. All the efforts that we're making, our efforts, the efforts of the extraterrestrials, etc., to try and transform the external world through technology, has no similarity to reality at all. None. And the means of perception is not stable. So that's the problem. I don't care how beautiful a park we make, a lovely place. If we don't have a stable means of perception, it doesn't solve the continuity problem at all. So literally, we need a new means of perception that the Holy Spirit provides for us. It's not a sensory, it's not based on the body. It's a spiritual vision. Spiritual means of perception. So no matter how much we toil on the estates of the aristocrats to turn it into a beautiful park, parkland, etc., that does not have similarity to both reality and perception. It does not bridge this continuity problem. It does not. Okay, it does not bridge this continuity problem. Now, I'm going to be going to maybe, I think, the most beautiful place in the world pretty soon. But the fact is that it doesn't solve the continuity problem. I've already been there and I know what it's like. And you can just gorge yourself on this beautiful, beautiful perception there. However, it doesn't solve the continuity problem, because the means of perception is not stable. So we'll see what happens there with this clarity and attitude that I have. On the same hand, it does provide a feeling like, hey, perception could be lovely. You know, perception could be really lovely. So that is actually, I believe that helps a little bit. I'm not sure, but I would say it probably does. Stretching the boundaries of perception, you say, wow, it's possible to maybe perceive something way more beautiful than I'm aware of. It's possible. See, it opens your mind to the possibility, like, wow, maybe it's possible that I can perceive. And using video and cameras and stuff expands our perceptual boundaries. So we say, you know what, maybe it's possible we could see something really, really lovely. But still, we have to have the means of viewing it has to be stable in order to be effective. So we do know what the remedy is. There's no question about it. We do know what the remedy is. We do know the problem. We do know that there is this massive push to dumb us down and force us into doubling down on arrogance, meaning we can make this world a suitable home for us so we can avoid the continuity problem. Okay, what the ego does, what the ignorance does, is attempts to avoid the continuity problem by saying, we're just going to stay here forever. This is fine for us. This is great for us. That's arrogance. That's doubling down on arrogance. It's avoiding the continuity problem. It's saying, we don't need any solution to it. We can be separate from reality. We can be separate from the prime creator. We're going to be our own prime creators. We don't need to go back home. We don't need to solve the continuity problem. That's what it's saying. That's what it's saying. Wow. Ah. Bunch of stuff raining down from the tree. So, we are in this period now where this arrogance is really working to soften us up. Once you get someone knocked down and you start pounding their head into the concrete, as it were. And the more days they are, the more you attack them, right? Because you want them to be just like a vegetable in a coma, as it were. So they're trying to put the world into a coma. Anesthetizing, comatizing the world, so that they can then come in and do their takeover, institutional takeover, and the will of people will just be broken. They'll be so confused, they're just clutching at straws, kind of thing. So we are in that phase now, and what I would like to encourage everybody is to get off your sofa. I know, and whatever program you have to get yourself in prime condition in every way, just decide, you know what, I'm gonna do this. I've been procrastinating for a long time. I have this exercise bike that and I'm just didn't use it all summer. I haven't used it. I say, what's the use? And now I realize, you know what, got to use it. Got to get it back in shape. Got to get your feet under you. Got to feel that you can start moving. Got to feel that you have some resiliency. Because we may have to, relocate in some fashion. That is quite possible. The ETs, have their fangs and claws into this world and are getting ready to devour it. And of course, we don't see that because it's using its proxies. It's very clever using proxies here in the world to do the softening up work for us, but they give the marching orders to the proxies. And they're like behind the scenes, like the puppet masters, really, pulling the strings. But again, it is all doubling down on arrogance. There's a massive doubling down on arrogance. And when you start doubling down on it, you feel lost. You feel lost. You feel helpless. And I'm telling you that everyone in this world is vulnerable to that right now. Everybody. I am vulnerable to it. I experienced this. I've been experiencing it. I am vulnerable to it. So in other words, humility is your greatest friend. Humility is your best ally. By far, I'm vulnerable to arrogance. I'm vulnerable to doubling down on it. I'm vulnerable to all the troubles, absolutely. So knowing that, then we say, okay, how do we avoid it now? Then you realize you have to work at it. You have to work at it. You're not immune to it. We're not immune here. Absolutely not immune. We still have the continuity problem. Continuity problems. The ego still has leverage over us. We're still arrogant. We're still vulnerable to doubling down on it, being convinced. We're still vulnerable to stupidity. All this stuff we're still vulnerable to. And therefore, recognize that you may have gotten punched pretty hard the last month or two, and you're kind of like your mind's in a whirl, like saying, whoa, wait a minute, What position do I take? What position do I take? And then you find out it's very difficult to stand sit on the fence right now, isn't it? Like, what position? How can I kind of stay neutral or something? I don't know. And you realize, it's getting tough, because the people you interact with, people and those who are doubling down on arrogance, will say stuff like little asides to you, whatever, and notice your reaction to them. And if you don't show assent, like, oh yeah, yeah, you know, your reaction, they'll read your reaction and say, wow, you're not with us. You're not with us. You haven't decided to double down on arrogance. Therefore, you're against them. And you might say, no, I'm just sitting on the fence. And they say, well, we don't want fence sitters. You have to be with us. If you're not with us, you're against us. So I'm telling you, sitting on the fence is no longer a strategy. If you are not seen as actively activist with them, with the programs, you will be seen as against the programs. You can't say, well, I'm weighing things. They say, what? The time for weighing is gone. You either you're not with us, you're against us. So it's fence sitting is over. I've been saying this for years. Get ready for the time when you need to make decisions and the fence sitting is over. So I would say, make an effort to optimize your functioning at this point. Just a little bit of time. Just do some stretching, get your flexibility going, get your diet right, and get your mind right, get your confidence there, and just see if you can push it for the next couple weeks. Push yourself a little for the next few weeks. Make a decision. Make a decision. Bad habits, you say, throw them off for a little while. Throw them off for a little while. Go on an austerity program for a little while here, for a couple weeks here. Because really, if you're not with them, they see you as against them entirely, even though that's not so. Because you may just be saying, well, look, I understand what your problem is. You have a problem with the continuity problem. So I'm not entirely against you. I'm just saying I know what the answer to the continuity problem is. So I'm insisting on that. And they'll read that as, no, you're against them. You want to defeat them. You hate them. You don't want the new world new world order. You know, you're a primitive. You want to go backwards. You want to rely on failed institutions and failed ideas. You know, you're stuck in the past. You're all this stuff, all this pejorative stuff, amazingly pejorative stuff. Of course, they can criticize you constantly with the most pejorative type of statements, but if you criticize them with even one statement, then you are an extremely wicked person who needs re-education. And ask yourself, is that really fair? Is that really fair? Is that just? Is that coming from a place of love and understanding? Not at all. It's coming from a place of extreme fear, extreme arrogance. That's where it's coming from. If someone were to criticize, you know, like my favorite teacher or something, I'd say, well, okay, you see some things you don't like. What are the things you see that you do like? And some things you don't like, I say, okay, there's no problem, fine. Not threatened by it at all. Not worried about you, nothing. It's fine. That's where you're at. That's where you're at. That's how you see things. You need to be able to weigh things. That's good. You need a discerning mind. You need, Jesus said, I came to bring a sword, the sword of discernment, so you can see the options clearly. What are the options? So you can make a right decision. Didn't come to bring submission. Right decision based on seeing what your options are. So we're headed into a situation now. I don't want any of you to get trapped at all. I don't want myself to get trapped. There is likely to be a big, big, big issue come up in the world. Yes, there is, very, very likely. And that may You know, it may basically galvanize people into feeling they need to rely on all the institutions of arrogance, and therefore they will just submerge their criticism, feeling that it's wrong. They will submerge their voice, feeling it's wrong. And that is a big, 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 big problem, and you don't want that to happen. You don't want that to happen. So hey, it's all on right now. Next 2 weeks, try and shed yourself of all bad habits. Next 2 weeks. Just do a 2-week program. 2-week program. Shed yourself of all the bad habits. Shake the dust off of your sandals, as it were. It's time to do that. Time to do that. And if I can do it, I'm a big procrastinator. Yeah, you can do it too. I hate exercise, but you can do it too. I don't like dieting. You can do it too. I can do it. You can do it. And keep your head up, keep your hope going, and have this very positive vibe. And say, you know what? It's too late. All these problems, submission. It's too late for submission. It's too late for submission to arrogance. It's too late to double down on arrogance. It's too late for all of that. All of the plans of arrogance, it's too late for those plans. You just remind yourself of that. And all right, so here we go. And it's a positive message now. You can do it. A couple of weeks, see where you are in a couple of weeks. And you should be shining at that time. Shed the dust of July. Shed it. Say, it's not for me, it's too late for that stuff. Came too late for me. It came too late. When somebody asks you, why did you not submit? You say, it came too late for me. It's too late. It's too late. I know about the Holy Spirit, and so it came too late. That's why. Okay, very great. That's it. Go for it.